Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Thank you. Welcome to the opening of the 2015 Callaloo Conference. I'm Marlon Ross, and I'll be moderating this evening's proceedings. We're tremendously proud of this annual gathering that we call the Callaloo Conference, now in its eighth year. The annual meeting is unusual in at least three aspects. First, it is the sole annual conference devoted exclusively to the African diaspora, its literature, arts, cultures, politics, and geographies. Second, it is a forum that gathers artists, activists, critics, scholars, and students of Africa and its diaspora, not only to the same conference, but more crucially to the same table, to reflect, debate, lament, rejoice, critique, and commemorate the multifarious legacies and yet unrehearsed futures of the diaspora. Third, like the journal for which it is named, this conference is unabashedly inter and transnational, determined to convene every couple of years in a different country whose locale compels us to remember the long stretch of African cultures across the globe, from Ethiopia, where we met in 2010, to the United Kingdom in 2013, to, we anticipate, Brazil in 2017. Yeah. Like previous conferences, this one offers a series of sessions and performances revolving around a theme, which we'll get to in a moment. This year's conference is bookended with two extraordinary keynotes. The opening keynote by celebrated Haitian-American author Edwidge Danticat, and the closing keynote by celebrated performance artist Clifford Owens, also in this space, Friday evening at 6. In addition to these keynotes, we have some exciting sessions, workshops, and roundtables scheduled for tomorrow, beginning at 9:30 a.m., as well as Friday morning at the same time. Unlike previous conferences, we've added to this year's event two public planning sessions, one for the 2016 conference meeting here Friday at 2 p.m., the second planning session for the 2017 Brazil conference meeting here Saturday at 9:30 a.m. We welcome all conference participants to join with us in shaping our next two conferences. It is most fitting that this year's conference, whose theme is monuments and memorialization, should settle here in Providence, hosted so generously by Brown University's Department of Africana Studies and its Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice. For Brown has become a leader and a model for how to memorialize with monumental substance the incredible history of slavery and the slave trade. There are fundamentally two contrary ways to memorialize, and thus two contrary kinds of monuments. Most monuments are committed to elicit the memory of future generations as slumbering retreat, to put us at ease with the past by wiping away its belligerent struggles and bloody injustices, as a way of reconciling us with the ongoing impact of those struggles and injustices in the present. Such monuments are plentiful and so familiar that we take their imposition as a natural right to occupy the landscape. Although ostensibly constructed to make us remember, they actually work by encouraging us to forget. I fear that in our current moment, a multitude of such slumbering monuments to slavery and the civil rights movement is upon us. If you've seen the recently installed Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial on the National Mall, you know exactly what I mean. My own institution, inspired by Brown, has recently decided to honor the slave past by naming two new residence halls in the name of two former slaves. A monument, I would say, with no teeth. This is memorializing to seal off the past as done and dealt with, an act of remorseful apology without an intention to use the wrongs of the past to transform the future. Rather than a slumbering monument, Brown has chosen to memorialize the past by intervening in the present in substantive ways that come at a real cost to the institution, a cost that diversifies, enriches, and transforms not only this institution, but also its relation to the city and to historically Black colleges and universities. We might call this a living monument with teeth. Although we have far fewer resources than Brown, we like to think that Callaloo, the journal, the conferences, the newly minted book series at Johns Hopkins University Press, are similarly an institution that remembers the past for the purpose of transforming the present. As Edwidge Danticat writes about one of the characters in her monumental novel, The Farming of Bones, quote, his creed was one of memory. How remembering, though sometimes painful, can make you strong, end quote. We might take this as our creed for the duration of this conference and beyond, to do the kind of remembering that refuses to suppress historical pains. In an interview, Danticat elaborates on this kind of memorializing, quote, we can remember alone or we can remember together, but someone somewhere will always remember. And it is what we do with that remembering that is most important. Do we use it to learn to be better people, better neighbors, or do we continue fighting the same battles over and over again? End quote. Not reconciliation, but reparation, constructing living monuments with teeth. We'd like to thank Brown hosting this year's conference, and we take it as yet another instance of its commitment to transformative remembering. Now, to welcome you formally, we are pleased to have the chair of Brown's English department and the Nicholas Brown Professor of Oratory and Belles Lettres, Philip Gould.
Thank you, Marlon. A tough act to follow. As a sidebar, I like my title because Oratorium Belles Lettres, we don't teach them anymore. So I'm a professor of the outmoded, you know. It's beyond old school, I suppose. I am Phil Gould, chair of the English department, professor here at Brown since the late 90s. And I'm kind of the surrogate or inadequate surrogate, I suppose, for Tony Bogues, who's professor of Africana Studies and the director of the Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice. So in very few words, and at the risk of being a little bit redundant for those of you that have been participating in the writing seminars, I just wanted to spend a very few minutes, literally, to just give you a context for the center as a way of welcoming you. In light of Marlon's remarks and my conversations with you and others, I think that there's a kind of intellectual synergy. It's suitable and fitting, and I think Callaloo's mission and the center's and Tony's vision for it do coincide significantly. The fact that he's not here, I think, is the first testament to the ambitions and the energy that he's brought to the center. He's abroad fundraising and giving talks and establishing international connections. The center was really, its origins, its genesis lies in the previous president of Brown, Ruth Simmons' decision in 2003 to appoint a university committee, a steering committee to deliver ultimately a report about Brown's, the history of slavery at Brown, and in a way that she wanted to be both academically thorough and scholarly, have a kind of scholarly consistency and consciousness to it, but to also reach much broader audiences. And indeed, when she even put the committee together, it made the front page of the Times. It was a big deal then, and it has, as you suggest, precipitated other institutions to step up, so to speak. So their charge was to prepare a report, and this wasn't just faculty, but it included undergraduate and graduate students, administrators as well. And it was asked to organize public programs that might help the campus and reflect on the meaning of this history of slavery in the present moment at Brown, and on the complex historical, political, legal, and moral questions posed by present-day confrontations with past injustice. The committee did its due diligence, produced a report, which I hope some of you have had a chance to read. It's fascinating, actually. You can get it on the center's website. There are hard copies in the building. And that was delivered in 2006, and by the next year, the corporation had backed it, and so the next step was in place. Out of that report, which made big news, since a leading university was fully and openly addressing its historical connection to the African slave trade and slave labor, the provost appointed a second committee that was charged with articulating what the center's mission would be and how it might operate. It's like the wheels of academe grind slowly. Nothing happens quickly. If you have friends in the private sector, in the business world, you know that the hiring or firing or changing of positions occurs in a weekend, which takes us an entire academic year. So after a number of years and some failed experiments with directors, Tony assumed the directorship, and in 3 short years has given the center direction and a kind of intellectual, institutional, and financial traction. The center combines both academic programs, lectures, symposia, those events, as well as those events targeting local communities outside of academia. It has a postdoctoral fellowship program. It has faculty and graduate students already. It has put on a number of academic conferences in the last 3 years, and it's put on exhibitions about slavery and justice, about race in America, that have started here, but also migrated transatlantically and traveled to other museums and intellectual and academic centers in Europe, in South Africa and West Africa. So as I was saying to the other group of the creative writing participants, that behind us is the center. There's an exhibition now on really about the aesthetics or how slavery has been represented the last few hundred years in American culture. And up the street at Hillel, there was a fascinating exhibition, which is typical of how the center works and operates, connecting 1863, the Emancipation Proclamation, with 1963, King's March on Washington. So without belaboring the point, I just want to underscore finally then the idea that this center, I think Marlon's exactly right that this is an initiative with teeth in it. It's substantial. It's not just a kind of political facade to appease certain constituencies, to gain press, to keep people happy, to make Brown look good. And I think that's largely due to initially Ruth Simmons' leadership and then to Tony's as well. It has already established itself as a major academic center that's connected now with museums in DC, New York, Senegal, the UK, Amsterdam. It has graduate programs, seminars that are operating in both The Hague and here for graduate students in Africana studies in Europe and in the US. But it also has a genuine public consciousness. Slavery and justice are an intellectual tandem that are inextricable. And I think that the center has also been quite robust and active in addressing Providence, the legacies of slavery on the city schools. And the center has become a forum and a voice for local communities far outside the academic endeavor with which to talk about and keep alive questions of slavery and justice. So I hope the next 4 days, I know the next 4 days will be, more interesting than listening to me. But I hope you enjoy Brown and get a chance to see some of Providence, and that, you know, it's a intellectually and socially vibrant week for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gould, for that very warm and cordial welcome. As I stated in the opening Callaloo workshop, Brown University is very fortunate to have a progressive leader as Professor Gould, a progressive leader as Professor Anthony Boggs, and a former president as Dr. Ruth Simmons. On matters of history, race and justice, and the intersection of these with the core curriculum program, we at this conference should view what you are doing as commensurate with what our goals are of the Callaloo Conference. Let me add that I think that in matters of this sort, Brown should be applauded for its leadership in these directions, which means that we as members of the conference can return to our individual colleges and universities, informing our own colleagues of what we have witnessed here in the progressiveness of Brown University. Thank you, Dr. Gould. I want also to thank Dr. Anthony Boggs and the staff of the Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice, and the staff of the Africana Studies Department for hosting the Callaloo Conference and the Creative Writing Workshop. To let some of you know who's who in this workshop, I want to introduce its four leaders, and I'm going to ask them to stand as I call their names. Vivi Francis in poetry. Ravi Howard in fiction. Gregory Pardlow in poetry. Jacinda Townsend in fiction. Now, let me tell you this. I did not tell these people to applaud. These are members of the workshop, and they are applauding because those leaders are extraordinary as teachers and extraordinary as writers. Otherwise, they would be with Callaloo. And let me add, too, that two of those leaders just won prizes. Jacinda Townsend, the James Fenimore Cooper Prize for Historical Fiction for her very first novel, Saint Monkey. And Greg Pardlow, the Pulitzer Prize for Digest, his second book of fiction, of poetry. I don't have to repeat that I think they're brilliant. And I don't have to repeat that I know they're excellent teachers. And that they represent the excellence for which Callaloo stands and for which Callaloo promotes. I now want to introduce the members of the Creative Writing Workshop. It's 32 strong, so a lot of people are going to stand. And they represent people from all across the globe in the United States and other parts of the world. So I'd like all the, and I can't call all of you by name. I would like all of you to stand so people will know who you are. Now you can see, conference members and visitors, that the Callaloo workshops, or Callaloo, has entities all over the world, that we are promoting things internationally, that the Callaloo workshop is international, and that our Anglophone Caribbean workshop is held at Barbados at the University of West Indies annually, and that our Anglophone Callaloo for Europe and the UK is held at Oxford University. So we are trying all we can to promote excellent writing. And not only this, but this is our fourth year at Brown University. So we should be very happy about this. I am very pleased that the two groups are coming together, the conference and the workshops, that they are converging at this time. And I hope the remaining days will help both groups to become acquainted with what each one is doing. I don't know whether the conference people knew about our workshops. I don't think our workshop people knew about our conference. So this is a good, great moment here at this time. This gathering of the conference is quite unusual. Why? Because it is a meeting to plan other meetings. And Regine Jean-Charles is laughing very strongly because she's one of the chairs of that meeting group. And Marlon Ross and Dagmawi Wupshet, within a telephone call on yesterday at a hello tonight, I'm asking them to lead the second group on Brazil. So let's applaud them for working. So the panel that Regine is chairing, along with the other members of that committee, is on memorialization. And it will take place, interesting enough, and I don't think they know, on the 40th year of the existence of Callaloo. Hint, hint. And the other conference on Brazil will take place in 2017. So start practicing samba so that we won't look awkward when we go. And I'm inviting all of you to come to Salvador de Bahia to join in that conference. And we will meet with academics there and artists there and writers there and exchange. We will not go as an occupying force telling people what they should do. You know, we want to know what they do so we can learn, and we will let them know if they want to know what we do. So it's going to be a mutual meeting, and we will also go early there to talk with academics a year before the program is gone. And some of you may also want to learn capoeira before we go too, or learn when you're there, go early. And I think I might be a little old to practice capoeira. I'll have to work on it before I get there. The use of the body is extraordinary, and such beauty also. I want to remind us that we at the Callaloo Conference want to acknowledge that we write, invent, and create as literary and cultural criticism, as fiction and poetry and drama, as painting, sculpture, installation, and performance, as music composition and dance, whatever we do should be equally valued, appreciated, respected by our colleagues, and by the administration who maintains the values and the boundaries imposed upon this current organizational structure called the Academy. We also want to remind departments and programs in which literary and cultural studies reign paramount that the attempt to continue to privilege the study of writings by Europeans and their descendants over that of those of other peoples, especially people of color, is obviously pernicious Eurocentrism, a form of academic apartheid, which has no place in this multicultural, multi-ethnic, multiracial society. I hope I don't sound like a troublemaker. And if I do, I applaud myself. Let us also remind Africana Studies departments and programs that of their needs to expand their curricula beyond the boundaries of the original projects that started in some 40 or 50 years ago. That is, beyond courses in literature, history, and the social sciences, to include courses in the fine arts, such as film studies, such as creative writing and other forms of writing, such as visual art and performance studies. Then, to the administrations of these same institutions, we say to them, they must fund the Africana Studies program at the same rates that they fund other departments or similar departments and programs. You are applauding now, but let me say this to you. I hope when you return to your institution that you will make this declaration among your colleagues and get them involved in changing things in those institutions and supporting and respecting the kind of work that you do and the subjects you pursue. Again, welcome to this conference. And I hope you take part in it. I hope you really raise questions, that you speak to the panelists aloud, that you critique what they do, and that you learn whatever you want to learn from it, but go home knowing that we need you now, we need you in the future, and I invite all of you to come again to the Callaloo conference and join and go with us to Salvador de Bahia, as well as wherever Regine and her committee decides to mount the next Callaloo conference. I have no idea. I'm turning it all over to them because I sound like an old dictator in the past, deciding all the conference topics and all. Now the conference members are in charge. So help them, help all of us. Thank you very much and welcome.
Good evening. I am Darlene Taylor. Last summer, I was sitting in those chairs there as a fiction workshop participant. And it was 2 weeks that taught me to touch the places that, for me, story comes from. So good luck to all of you. Thank you, Dr. Rowell, to Jackson Brown, to everyone in the family of scholars and writers who are Callaloo. Thank you, Brown University, for inviting us into your home. I have the pleasure tonight of introducing Edwidge Danticat. And to me, this is a very special privilege. And I'm sure for all of us, it's special to hear her as she shares stories. Writers like Edwidge are important to us. She urges us to follow our hearts, to write. As I was thinking about the Callaloo conference opening, Monuments and Memorialization, I was rereading her book, Create Dangerously. And I was reflecting on the legacy of her work and all who create dangerously, those who dare to create. That book explores the voice of the immigrant artist and is inspired by a lecture by Albert Camus in which he says, "Great ideas come into the world as gently as doves. As a result, there shines forth fleetingly the ever-threatened truth that each and every man and woman, on the foundation of his and her own sufferings and joys, builds for all. Truth is threatened in silence. Edwidge writes against the silence. She is a builder of monuments. With a deep vision and boldness, she shows us what it is to create from the heart, from pain, sorrow, happiness, and tenderness. She dares us to question and challenge. Her voice urges us to dig into places explored and unexplored, to be truthful storytellers, to be a witness. as an author who is unafraid to touch the broken places in people's hearts and lives. She is creating monuments, remembrance, and restoration. She was born in Haiti and received the MFA in creative writing from Brown University in 1993. She is the author of more than 15 books of fiction, creative nonfiction, and texts for young adult readers. Some of those titles include Claire of the Sea Light, Brother I'm Dying, Farming of the Bones, Breath Eyes Memory, Behind the Mountains, The Dewbreaker. For her work as a writer, she has been given a number of awards and honors. National Book Critics Circle Award, Andrew Carnegie Medal for Excellence in Fiction, the MacArthur Foundation Genius Grant. She has an honorary doctorate from Smith College and Yale University. She lives in Miami, and we're happy to have you here with us tonight. Thank you.
Good evening. Let me put my earring back on. What great kindness. Thank you. Thank you, Darlene, for that very kind introduction. It's wonderful to be here at this conference. Thank you, Dr. Rowell, Dr. Ross. I am a big Callaloo person. I have taught at the conference in College Station, Texas. I've been one of my first publications was actually in the journal at Callaloo. So I am extraordinarily happy to be here. I want to do some, I guess, personal memorialization here. I am a graduate, as Darlene said, of the MFA program here at Brown. And this theater, this space, is especially resonating for me because when I came to Brown, I didn't think of myself as a playwright. I came here as a fiction writer, but I had the opportunity to have a play performed here in this space, and it was a play called The Creation of Adam, and I wrote the play after the death of Yusuf Hawkins in 1989, when Yusuf Hawkins was killed by a mob of white teenagers in Bensonhurst, not far from where I came from in Brooklyn, New York. So this week I was thinking all over again about this play and the fact that I was coming here, and it was very sad how so little had changed in the world in all those many years. So making monuments in the performance of memorialization, I started thinking also a lot about Brazil and Haiti in particular, because when I was here, in addition to two memorable things, in addition to this play, a friend introduced me to a song called Aichi, in a version by both Caetano Veloso and Gilberto Gil. And it's a song that's always stayed with me. And I think it's a song that will allow me a little bit of entry here in trying to make some connection between Brazil and Haiti, just as this conference will be trying to connect all of us to Brazil. And please invite me for 2017. I would like to come. But some of the lyrics in that song, Aichi, have guided me in what I've chosen to read to you this evening, and I'll read a few of those lyrics to you. When you were asked to step up on the atrium at the home of Jorge Amado, who's a wonderful Brazilian author, at the home of the Jorge Amado Foundation, to see from above the lines of soldiers, almost all black, beating the necks of blacks, from mulattoes to other almost white, treated like blacks, just to show the other blacks, and they're almost were all black, and the poor whites are all just like blacks. This is how the blacks, the poor, and the mulattoes, and the almost white are almost black from such poor treatment, and it doesn't matter if the world's eyes can just for a moment look to where the slaves were once punished. No one is a citizen. Think of Haiti, pray for Haiti. Haiti is here, Haiti is not here. These are the lyrics from the Caetano Veloso song. There's a lot to unpack here, but I'd rather not see the song as an example of Haiti as everyone's dystopia, but as an act of memorialization through creative expression, music and song, literature and art, which is sometimes the best bridge of all. So I would like to open by reading to you a piece I wrote when I was here at Brown. It's called Legends, and it's about a desire I had to tell stories. And it's especially for you guys who are in the writing workshop here, because I know that's what brought you here, this desire that I felt so powerfully when I was here, almost like a deep hunger. And it was a desire to tell stories to myself, to others in the world. But the piece I'm about to read is also about a little girl's desire to tell a story to her immigrant mother, who I later realized also wanted to tell me stories. It's about a mother who works in a sweatshop in the US while dreaming of telling stories to her daughter back home in Haiti. And the legends in the story are these Tontomacouts, who were the henchmen of the dictatorship and who come from a long tradition of military oppression that goes back to ways that the U.S. occupation, which will be 100 years soon in July, I remember in my family we were told these stories about a three-legged horse named Galipot. It was a Galipot, 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 and during the U.S. occupation, children would hear the boots of the U.S. Marines and merge that with the legend. So the U.S. Marines became the legends of myths that you were told. So, legends. Once upon an endless night, I dreamed of telling you a story, of pleading you a tale out of my breath and carving it into your flesh with my hair. And since the story could be my last, I wanted it to be a perfect story. Not perfect in execution, but perfect only in intent. The stories my mother told were always too frightening for us. She worried, my mother did, that I would remember too much. I worry that you will forget. Forget nights of women with wings of flames who want to draw you out of your bed and make you into a star. Nights of galipot, 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 or three-legged horses riding at full speed to either snatch or rescue children who had lost their way. Lost their way from where, you ask? From their country, I say. And what of the children who had no way to lose? And what of the children who had no country? Then the three-legged horses would not want them, I say, because what comes too easy, nobody wants. What comes too easy does not make legends. Nobody is ever outright handed a pot of gold where we come from. We must cross forest, jungles, oceans, unearth the tail end of rainbows. We must vine our hair out of window panes and sleep 100 years. And what if the sleeping beauty never awakens with her secret? That, Mache, we will call death. In our legends, we are beautiful first. A charmed vision comes to claim us. We go off to the enchanted land, then we find out that the vision had only borrowed its face. Still, we are not foolish enough to lie 100 years and wait. Even if they say we are zombies, even if they say we have powders that keep the dead beneath the ground until they jolt awake. And what was that girl, that sleeping beauty, if not a zombie? And what was it that gave her the freedom from the sleeping sickness, if not the taste of salt on the prince's lips? Let no one tell you that it was the man's breath itself. Everyone knows, or mama knows, that it was the salt. It is always the salt that wakes the dead and frightens away the three-legged horses and brings the children home. Once, while peddling at a sewing machine under a fan blowing dust balls into my face in a crowded castle called a sweatshop, I dreamed of telling you a story. not like the stories my father told of land invasions and foreign masters, of the Makuts and their timid eyes, which they hid behind X-ray glasses. In my childhood, the Makuts were legends, breeders of night soil who came with their knapsack for children who did not do as they were told. In your childhood, the Makuts were soldiers, transformed by the fears of a madman whose own mother must have told him to listen, listen in the night for the machetes scraping the palmetto so he would stay inside. A man who may have watched as the Marines had come to our shores and as if the consternations of our nights were not deformed enough, now there are breeders of night soil to frighten the adults too. Gunboats to replace the knapsacks, bullets to succeed the machetes, and your grandfather who died in a chain gang chiseling a song with his fist. And when you awaken, then what? Kisa, then what? And this is why these stories I dream for you are more yours than mine. One day there might be time for you to ponder these questions from some office castle or some university tower or a public plaza. But do not forget the three-legged horses. Do not forget the night women and their wings. Do not forget the children lost to the night stars. Do not forget those we have left behind. Mothers who, even as they are standing over them, are still carving stories into their daughters' dreams, stories they might never be able to tell them, that they might never be able to tell anyone, stories they might be ashamed to tell, stories that one day they will need interpreters for, stories that you will acknowledge at last when you read them in a book. My mother's favorite story, an ancient one, 100 years ancient, of a French general once master of the Haitian colony, a French general who gave a massive ball for all the colored women of the capital whose men had been called away. It was the first ball anyone knew of where so many colored women came, curious by the general's sudden interest in their joy. At midnight, the dancing stops, and the French general comes, and soldiers dressed in cassocks part of red velvet curtain and chants a mass for the dead. And behind the red velvet curtain are rows and rows of coffins, and the French general names them each one by one to tell the women, "Oh God, you thought you had been dancing the solo minuet when really you were dancing all this time with your dead men." Perhaps we have all been in the coffin with these men and in the silencing dusk with these women, sleeping our 100 years of shame, waiting for the salt. Once, while cradling someone else's child in my arms, standing at a kitchen stove, stirring a soup for the child's hunger, I dreamed of telling you a story that rains with salt. I am telling you to open your mouth and catch as much of the salt as you can. The salt sizzles on your tongue, and suddenly you understand why your mother is Lord Bodlo across the waters, and suddenly you understand why she has crossed these waters, but not the truly endless waters, just a tiny sea. And this is why this is not the first sea, nor the only sea that we have ever crossed. And in the mirror, you see your mother's face, and in the night, you hear your mother's voice, drowning out the vacant stars, drowning out the galipot, drowning out the machetes and gunboats, drowning out your tears. And the story she likes to tell you best is of a mother who every day, when she came home from the castle factory, would stand outside your bedroom forest and sing you a simple song. And observing this one day, a devil waited until she was gone and came to your doorstep and tried to imitate that song. At first, the voice was too low, and you knew and did not come. But when your mother sang, you came. When the devil came again with a voice that was too high, you knew and did not come. But when your mother sang, you came. Saint Rose de Lima, now I am frightened that you will no longer know your mother's voice. And this is why I try to carve these stories into your dreams so that you will not be deceived by birds and wolves and three-legged horses who want to take you into the night. And this is why I try to carve these stories into your dreams so that not only will you always remember the sound of my voice, but yours as well. Once, at least once, each night before I put my head to rest, I dream of telling you a story. I tell you the story, not certain if you will even know how to discern my voice in a place so far from home. I tell you the story, not knowing if you will stay silent or sing it back to me, but I have no choice but to tell you the story. It is all I dream. It is all I know. It is all I have. It is all I am. Thank you. I wanted to read this because it leads me a little bit into some of the textual memorializing that I've tried to do. I don't think of it like I'm going to textually memorialize now, but especially in my collection of essays, which Darlene mentioned, Create Dangerously. Create Dangerously is a book about how artists came to their art. And some of the artists are people I know, and some of them are people I know only in the spirit. So the bit that I'll read you from Create Dangerously has to do with a photographer friend of mine, Daniel Morel, who was present at an execution when he was a very little boy. He decided right then and there that he would be a photojournalist because he would, after he had witnessed the execution, he then would walk down the street and see the photographs everywhere. And he decided, I will do this with images, but I will do it for good. So this is from Create Dangerously. On November 12, 1964, in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, a huge crowd gathered to witness an execution. The president of Haiti at that time was the dictator François Papadoc Duvalier, who was 7 years into what would be a 15-year term. On the day of the execution, he decreed that government offices be closed so that hundreds of state employees could be in the crowd. Schools were also shut down and principals ordered to bring their students. Hundreds of people from outside the capital were bussed in to watch. The two men to be executed were Marcel Numa and Louis Douin. Marcel Numa was a tall, dark-skinned 21-year-old. He was from a family of coffee planters in a beautiful southern town in Haiti called Jérémie, which is often dubbed the City of Poets. Numa had studied engineering at the Bronx Merchant Academy in New York and had worked for an American shipping company. Louis Douin was also from Jérémie. He had served in the U.S. Army and had studied finance before working for French and American banks in New York. The two men had remained friends when they had moved to New York in 1950s after François Duvalier came to power. There they had joined a group called Jeune Haïti and were two of 13 Haitians who fled, who left the United States for Haiti in 1964 to engage in a guerrilla war that they hoped would eventually topple the dictatorship. After months of attempting to capture these men and imprisoning and murdering hundreds of their relatives, Papadoc wanted to make us skeptical of Numa and Numa and Duin's death. So on November 12, 1964, the members of the firing squad would pick up their Springfield rifles, load their ammunition, and then place their weapons on their shoulders and shout fire, and they do. Numa and Duin's head stomp sideways at the same time after they have been shot, showing that these shots have hit home. On November 12, 1964, after Marcel Numa and Louis Duin were executed, a lanky 13-year-old boy who had been standing in the back of the crowd to avoid the thunderous sounds of the executioner's guns step forward as the spectators and soldiers scattered. The young man, Daniel Moel, momentarily held the eyeglasses of Louis Douin in his hands before they were snatched away by another boy. But in that moment, he noticed tiny chunks of Douin's brain splattered on the cracked lenses. Perhaps if he had kept them, he might have cleaned the lenses and raised them to his face to try to see the world the way it might have been reflected in a dead man's eyes. Often, the eyes of murdered victims are gouged out by the dictatorship because it is believed that even after death, the last image a person sees remains imprinted on his or her cornea as clearly as a photograph. Before witnessing the execution of Marcel Numa and Louis Douin, Daniel Moel was not particularly interested in dead men's eyes. He had been like any other boy, going for long walks all over Port-au-Prince and playing soccer with his friends. He sometimes worked in his father's bakery and tried to climb aboard Haiti's commercial train with bought sugarcane stalks from the southern fields to the plant in Port-au-Prince. The next day, Daniel walked by a photographer's studio near his father's bakery in downtown Port-au-Prince, and on the open panel doors were enlarged photographs on Marcel Numa and Louis Douin's corpses, purposefully put on display as deterrents for the country's potential dissenters. The pictures were exhibited there and elsewhere for weeks, and young Daniel would walk past them, and even though he had been at the execution, he saw them each day as if for the first time and was unable to look away. That's when I decided to be a photojournalist, Daniel recalled more than 45 years later while sitting with me in my home. Photography is an elegiac art. The novelist and essayist Susan Sontag writes, and on photography, photography has something to do with resurrection. We might say of what the Byzantines said of the image of Christ, which impregnated St. Veronica's napkin, might we not say that of photography, that it was not made by the hand of man? Might we not say the same of all impassioned creative endeavors? I never intended to become a photojournalist, Daniel Moel tells me more than once. I became a photojournalist because at Numa and Dwayne's execution, I felt afraid, and I never wanted to feel afraid again. I'm going to close with just a short to bring us back to the storytelling, and also the idea that Professor Ross brought up of us as being a living monument. The first time I heard about this notion of human beings being what in Creole we call a reposoir, a kind of sacred place of for others to rest, was when my first niece and nephew were born, and a friend said that to me. So this final piece is called Transition, and it's about my father died a few weeks after my oldest daughter was born, and I could see my father in the last month we spent together trying to pour everything he had into this baby, trying to make each of us a monument, and I hope that it inspires your work as some of you are making your own transitions from student writers to published writers, from scholars to those who will go out and share with your students. This is called Transition. There's a stage in labor called transition, when the baby, preparing to separate from the mother, twists and turns to pass through the birth canal. I'm sure that there's a similar stage for exiting life, though it might be less definitive. Still, as I go into labor with my daughter, each time I wish for an easy transition for my daughter and myself, I wish the same for my dying father. Our midwife encouraged me to add some personal touches to the labor room at the birthing center, so I bought two old photos of my mother and father. In his picture, my father is a handsome, serious-looking 26-year-old. My mother in hers is wearing a check blouse with a giant button on the front. When the midwife sees my mother's picture, she thinks my mother is me. I looked at my parents' sepia-toned faces, intermittently during the 16 hours that I walked, laid down, sat in a tub, on a ball, on a toilet, in constant agony. How could my mother have done this 4 times, I wondered. When my daughter was born, her face blood-tinted, her eyelids swollen with tiny light pink patches that the midwife called angel kisses, I instantly saw it as one of many separations to come. She was leaving my body and going into the world where she would spend the rest of her life moving away from me, I thought. Groggy and exhausted, I asked the midwife, "Is it normal for me to think this?" "Well, maybe you're one of those women who enjoys being pregnant," she says. "It wasn't so much that," I told her. "I simply liked the fact that for a while my daughter and I had been inseparable." Looking at her tiny face, her bow-shaped lips so red that her father said she looked like she was wearing lipstick, I remembered a message a girlfriend had sent me when my first niece and nephew were born. "May you be a reposoir," she had written, "a place where others can rest." I needed to rest myself, but I also wanted to speak to my daughter, cradle her, sing to her. I thought she most resembled my mother and pointed at the picture to prove it. But I also saw traces of my father. I grieved for my relatives in Haiti who had died, the ones who would never get to hold her, or maybe she would return to their gravesite one day to declare in heavily accented words that they were her family. Looking into my daughter's eyes, I thought of my mother who had faced these first hours alone after I was born. She had been made no promises, been offered no guarantees that either she or I would live past the night. My daughter's quiet yet monitored first night was perhaps the only reason we had all made this journey to this new place. "What have you decided to call her?" the midwife asked. My husband and I had discussed it. There seemed to be no possible other choice. "Mira," I said, "for my dying father." After patiently waiting his turn to hold her, my husband held out his hand. I was so reluctant to let this Mira go, too. Hopefully, we would have an uninterrupted lifetime together. But I was also feeling an urgent wish to hand my daughter over to my father. "Look, Papa," I would say, "you have waited for her. You've lived long enough to see her. Today is not just her birthday, but all of ours too. And we are not the only ones who will cradle and protect. She will also hold and comfort us. She too will be our reposoir, our sacred place to rest." Thank you. Thank you, guys. You're spoiling me. I may never leave. You can manage. Okay. Yes.
So, wonderful author. Take questions. Here's your chance.
I have to like wipe my nose before I can get this out. Oh, I don't need a microphone.
Thank you so much.
We're recording.
I need a microphone. we're so glad to have you here. We were asked in class this week with Vivi about the emotional wheelhouse that we write from. And I'd be curious to know if you would share that with us.
My emotional wheelhouse, I feel like I've just laid it all out. I feel like we all walk around with this pool of experience that keeps going, and life encounters and things that we deal with, and we that we pull from all the time. You know, in this essay, To Create Dangerously, that inspired the title of my book. I mean, talks about that. He says sort of all writers, all artists have sort of a series of moments when our heart first opened, where our arts keep opening, and often that's what we draw from our works. Certainly, for me, it's having to leave a place where I thought I would always be suddenly at age 12, and then landing in Brooklyn, New York, and then eventually as I've gotten older, the birth of my children, the death of my parents, and emotional milestones along the way that sometimes, even if you're not writing about them, might be sort of the undercurrent of your work. But I think in terms of transferring that in a way that's useful to others is it's just important, and as writers, to find those spaces for you and to not be afraid to go there, whether emotionally or politically in other ways. But I always think sometimes you see people who are writing and you could see that there's something they're not writing that if they wrote it would so free them to write other things. Like they have a big iceberg in front of them, like write the iceberg away even if you don't publish it, just so you could get that thing out of you and then you can be free, because otherwise you're like circling it for a long time.
Thank you.
I think it's an occupational hazard we all have, right, that like no one can go to the movies with us because we hear things as writers. But I heard what you just wrote as a person, and I'm usually unaffected, but you had me sniffling at line three, right? So I was wondering if you can talk a little bit about how you have evolved as you've gotten older, as you become a parent, as you've lost your own parents. Are you writing more nonfiction? Do you find yourself writing in a different way? Like how things have changed for you?
Mm-hmm. Well, I heard Zadie Smith say, like, after her father dies, she's like, it's almost like once you, when you lose a parent, there's something else that, you know, when you lose your parents, that kicks inside of you as a person. And it's a process that I'm just going through. My mother passed away not too long ago. So there, even, you know, I think as we get older, as we're exposed to more things, there's probably more nuance in certain experiences that I think has touched the way I write and also has led me to a quest for more nuance, you know, to understand some of the situations that I'm writing about in a much deeper way. And that comes with sort of more living, more reading, more observations, and trying to capture also characters that are very different than you are, and trying to understand what it's like to be other people you may not necessarily like, and who might have very different points of view than you do, and all those things. Now, I mean, as I've gotten older, I understand why they would say to people, go live a little, you know, like, you can do both simultaneously, you can, but I think what's changed, like, if what your wheelhouse of experience, the things that you're drawing from, like, your source is deeper, so hopefully the work deepens, and it might deepen in ways that even if others don't notice, that you notice.
Thank you so much, Edwidge. This question is somewhat related. I'm not sure if it's a comment or a question. I've been thinking a lot about mothers and daughters. Thank you for that beautiful piece. It's just, I'm glad it's not just me, the pregnant person that was crying. I've been thinking a lot about mothers and daughters, and specifically Haitian mothers and Haitian daughters. And it's such a, you know, I've read your work, written about your work, taught your work, lived with your work from the time I was in college. And it's such a strong theme throughout. And I remember Imani Perry telling me that she was told that her writing, she was told by one of her mentors that her writing changed after she had children and they could see the change, but the person couldn't describe it. And I think that for you, what's remarkable to me is this amazing consistency. Like, even that piece that you wrote when you were still in school, I heard some of the same things about the daughters that resonated for me from different texts of yours. And so just thinking about, you know, Claire of the Sea Light, and the ways that, you know, just Haitian girls are written, right? And written through the lens of the mother or the daughter, and how powerfully you're able to evoke that more than I think is even present in the whole canon of Haitian literature, right? Which you can, you know, you can tell me if you agree with that. Mm-hmm. So I'm just curious to hear your thoughts about, and again, like I said, it's a comment slash question, but I'm really curious to just hear your thoughts about those, you know, just writing that mother-daughter, you know, relationship. And even like, you know, thinking about, I remember that time we were talking about Marie Chauvet, right? And the way that her legacy was, you know, being protected by her children. And you said, well, I would like to think that, you know, I wonder what will happen to my daughters in terms of the legacy of my work. You know, so there are just so many rich ways that you enter into that conversation. I was hoping you could just say something.
Yeah. Well, I think the my approach, again, goes back to the wheelhouse of experience. I spent, you know, my childhood away from my mother. So my mother and I had 2 years together when I was little, and my first memory is of me going to the airport with my mother, and then they had to peel me off of her because I thought I was going to New York with her, but then nobody, and then it's like, oh no, you're staying, and she got on the plane, and I think it was, and she and I have revisited that scene over from her perspective, from my perspective. So I think I was first interested in writing mother and daughter relations because I wanted to see some at play, and I could write them, you know. And so I think that was for me the draw. And then writing, then it shifts, that experience shifts from like the perspective of being both daughter and mother at the same time, and that shifts. But there's so many, I think also in Haitian folklore, there's so many sort of mother-daughter stories, and I would sometimes I think, is it because of infant mortality? Because there's so many stories that often it seems like they're preparing young women to be motherless, right? And you know, and the stories are always these obstacles to happiness. You know, they're similar like the stepmother stories, but the child has to be, you know, usually it's a girl, has to be so resilient, has to be so crafty about surviving. So I think I was also fed on the stories, these types of legends, you know, which I almost used as survival guides for myself. Like, okay, maybe I can sing a song that will transform, you know, like in the folktales, the girl sings and trees start to grow, and things like when you're little, you sort of you're up that whole imagination. So for me, I guess I tried to write through it the way I didn't live it, and tried write different versions of it, some close to mine, some close to others. But I get to do the flip side now because, you know, I'm sure I'm terrified of all the things that, you know, my daughters might have to say. But I would read, you know, before, also when I was writing about, you know, my books, I would read Jamaica Kincaid's. I think she writes mother daughters very powerfully and very, you know, fiercely, if you will. And we had seen each other after her mother passed away, and then you sort of have a shift of subject, you know, because you also have a shift of how you examine those relationships. But there's also, I mean, in addition, in Haitian literature, there's also mother as not just your biological mother, but you have different mothers, motherland, and you know, and the goddess mothers. There's a lot of layers to it too that I try to also tap into.
I'm just curious, how has your writing impacted writers in Haiti, and how has your work been received in Haiti?
Well, I feel like probably writers in Haiti have impacted my work more than I have impacted theirs. But I think what I was at the beginning of something in Haiti. There were two of us. There was a woman named Micheline Dussek, who had written her novel in Spanish. She was living in Spain. And there were maybe two of us here, Anne-Christine Dedeschi and me, who had written a novel in English. And I think what it's, if anything, it's done, it's I would sit sometimes in Haiti, Regine would be at those conferences, I would sit at these conferences and listen to people debate like where our work fits in, right? And so I think that's, you know, we're probably in the diaspora, a million of us, Haitians born, you know, Haitian American. So I think it's started this conversation about sort of what the artistic, where the artistic production of people like me fit in terms of what it means to Haiti, what it sort of where it fits in. I'm not sure there was any answer decided by any kind of committee, but I think the conversation is an interesting one because as our children and our children's children evolve and sort of, and we're not the only ones having it. You know, Julia Alvarez wrote a wonderful essay about this in her book, Something to Declare, about going to the Dominican Republic to a conference and being confronted by the grand dame of Dominican Lettres asking her, like, where do you fit in? And basically she wrote an essay to respond. So we're never alone discussing these things, even though it feels like we are. I go to Haiti often, sometimes to things literary. So I'm considered perhaps a diaspora writer because I live in the diaspora. Some people like my work, some people don't, like with anything else.
But if I may add, I know that I'm a good friend of Edwidge. I'm going to add something that she did not answer. She's being very modest. She has helped tremendous Haitian writers in terms of bringing them translation, Justine Trio and others, and also very gracious whenever she's invited somewhere, always make sure that she has invited other people to come, other poets and other writers, including myself. So she's being very humble in that sense. And I'd also say that, unfortunately, some of the folks who disliked her work, it's because the market in English, it's huge in comparison to French, and her success is felt as if, who are you to write for us? And I will continue to say, keep writing, because what you've done is beautiful. Keep doing it. So, my question to you. Oh,
there's a question, too. Merci, buddy.
Many of you probably did not know, but Edwidge started writing poetry. I think, you know, one of the earlier work was published in Caribbean Writers. And also, I remember finding a semi-erotic writing of yours. So, oh yeah, no, this is good. But it's public, it's public. So the question is...
No, it was not written to him.
No! Troublemaker. So the question is, would you go back...
To the semi-erotic?
To poetry? Would you go back to writing poetry or perhaps pushing the envelope? Because in the sense, I think you may be like the first Haitian woman who sort of wrote in this particular genre. Is that something that would you do in terms of pushing the envelope a little bit further?
You want me to say that I'm going to write poetry in the presence of such great poets? probably not, no, Patty. Once you go fiction, you don't go back. Okay, he shut it down. Okay. Okay. Oh no, no! I was gonna say thank you, but you may ask your question.
Thank you.
The form, I think it's a relatively common form of writing now, so that's, they call it the story cycle or novel in stories. And you can help me with the maïs condé. Maïs condé has the mangroves, crossing the mangroves. Yeah, that that novel is told that way. And I think it's sort of, for us in our tradition, this kind of mimics sort of the a call voice, like different people in the village telling the same, you know, different versions of the same story. And Claire of the Sea Light is more like that, a sort of a choral book in which you go to different characters. And the Dewbreaker, I felt when I was writing that book, I started with one story, and then something was mentioned in the story that I thought, oh, I wonder what they mean. So I wrote that part to flesh it out. But then when the book was done, I realized I couldn't tell the story of sort of people who had survived the dictatorship any other way. You needed different voices to tell that. And Claire was also about a whole town. But I realized people, and this is also for the writers of fiction, some people think you're lazy when you're doing that. They think you just don't want to write a novel. You just want to put your stories together and call it a novel. But for me, it was always sort of the group voice, sort of like the community speaking. It's not something that I think I want to do again, because I've heard that so much, where people think, you want your stories to pass off as a novel. And not that I'm being guided by people, but I also, I want to just explore other ways of telling a story. But it's that kind of way of telling a story is wonderful if you want to tell a multi-vocal, sort of multi-narrative story.
I think one of the things about the Callaloo workshop is that the instructors help us get down and chisel into the iceberg you mentioned. And I'm wondering, do you depend on peers, or are you at a point that you can do that for yourself, that you can chisel away at the iceberg that you're writing about as you enter each stage of your career, your interest?
Well, I right before we came in, I was talking to three members of the fiction workshop, and one of the things that I wanted to share with them is that how valuable this experience is. When I was here, it's a great institution, great program, but I was nobody understood what I was doing in class. You know, I had to, it was exotic, I had to explain myself in a way that in a workshop like this you don't have to. And so in the summer when I was here, I would go, there's a program in Miami, the Caribbean Writers Workshop, and I was in that workshop for 2 weeks. That helped me the rest of the time. So it's a little bit, it's wonderful to have this cocoon in a way. And I've taught in the program, to have your experience already validated when you enter. That you don't have to be validating each time your work comes up, or each time you open your mouth, or have to defend your right to be somewhere. That's a thing you should take with you wherever you go. It's extraordinarily important and extraordinarily valuable. So for me, I had these folks at the Writers Workshop. I remember George Lamming, who was taught here at Brown. The program got a little, there were more different, it got a little more multicultural afterwards. But when George was my teacher at one of the programs at the University of Miami. And back then I was this kind of writer, I was so worried about boring people that I was like, bam, bam, this is my story. And he was like, slow down, trust your story. And I've always carried that with me. So whatever you can get, you know, whether it's the friendship or the fellowship here, it's easier to carry that, to take it with you, to stay in touch and all that. So really, treasure that. So for me, I've always been a little bit shy to share. So I had one experience, I also when I was here, where I told someone, I want to write the story. It had to do with Brazil, too. I said, I want to write the story about a Brazilian woman. This one, someone like, you don't know anything about Brazil. So that shut down my story. So ever since then, I never tell people what I want to write about until it's done, and then I share it. So that's my own particular. But everybody, you know, when we're here speaking or you're sharing your experience, you have to, what you get out of it is not that you can replicate somebody else's, but that you can find, like, your best way to work. You know, because we don't all have the same lives, we don't all have the same circumstances, and, you know, to try to do whatever it seems like within the circumstances of your life. If you need a community, if you need to share, definitely, but if you're also one of those people who need to withdraw and then present the work when it's done, you should also do that. You have to follow your instinct, because also the work is so much about instinct. It's coming from this deepest part of you. So you might as well, in terms of how you want to frame it, who you want to share it with, how you want to protect it, which is, you know, it's important to also keep all those things in mind. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.